This is BBC One Scotland. And now we present the first of a new series of Cause for Concern.
The London Borough of Hackney's answer to a social disaster called high-rise housing. And if the misery of tenants is reason enough to demolish tower blocks, perhaps it's time Glasgow thought about demolishing these three.
There's dirt in the room. It's no bigger than a prison cell. That's two wains in the one room.
These properties should be pulled down, got rid of, because there are no houses, they're hovels, they're not even fit for the dogs that live up there. They're terrible.
What we are saying is, it's an absolute joke. We don't want them, we don't need them, it's not working, and if the local authority's not prepared to do something about it, then central government should.
This block is 20 Rosemount Street, Roystonhill. Built in 1968, 24 floors, 6 flats per floor, so 144 families, more or less, live here. And it's one of over 250 throughout Glasgow. Certainly not the best, but perhaps not the worst either. So week in, week out, what's it like to be at the sharp end of the great British housing disaster? Monday morning, a queue of tenants waiting for the doors to open at the local housing office. Some people are here just to pay their rent, or perhaps have come to put in requests for a transfer. But mostly, being Monday, it's the never-ending business of reporting faults, all sorts of faults, from persistent dampness to broken locks. And they've piled up over the weekend, so that Monday's the day the staff in the office dread, and the tenants don't enjoy it much either.
And your flat number?
13-6.
13-6.
You still got problems?
Oh, yes.
Mrs. Elizabeth Fraser's a regular caller at the office. Not because she's the complaining type. It's just that for 2 years, and despite several attempts to cure the problem, her house is badly affected by damp.
Can you tell me why you didn't come up last Wednesday?
It's a frustrating business, both for the tenants and the staff in the housing office, because the staff know only too well that with a housing budget cut to the bone, the desperate need for repairs can only get worse.
Certain repairs do take a long time to be carried out. Dampness repairs, for instance, take a tremendously long time to be carried out. Let's be honest about it. I mean, that's the simple facts. Normal routine repairs usually are attended to fairly quickly. The problem is that because of the deterioration of the housing stock, more and more repairs are required to be done. If I could give you an example, a simple example, like rota painting. Theoretically, we should really repaint all our houses and closes and window frames and whatnot every 5 years. Now, in order to do that, I would need a budget of 1.6 million. My budget this year is somewhere around about £50,000 for the whole district. So I just can't look at it, so the stock deteriorates.
This is the 16th floor, flat number one, and the Frasers live here with their grandson, Thomas.
What's the worst problems you've had with this bathroom?
That up there, the crack up there. Up at the top. You can see it.
Aye, I can see it.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, that's dear. Right. There's just black mould up there.
Big crack right across it.
What, and I mean, have you tried to keep it decorated? Or?
Yeah, we can't touch it at all.
Does the paper just peel off?
Just peels off.
And is that what happens in the boys' room?
Yeah, that's what happens in the boys' room.
Can I get a wee look?
Yes.
Right, OK. Does he do his own room?
Oh, yes, he's a paper and decorator.
This room belongs to the Fraser's grandson, Thomas. Now, you can see the wallpaper coming off the walls, but you'll just have to take my word for the terrible smell of dampness throughout the house. It's so bad that Mrs. Fraser couldn't even invite her sisters home when they were back home recently in Scotland after 28 years abroad. So dampness means being ashamed of your own home.
I've been here about 5-6 months and I've always adopted the attitude that when dealing with tenants you should always tell the truth. I don't think that there's any mileage in trying to be smart and keep things under wraps and whatnot. I think you should tell them the truth.
I'm sure tenants do appreciate honesty when you spell out figures like that to them. But can you understand them when they say, that's policy? What I'm concerned about is the fact that I'm living in an impossible environment.
At the first meeting of the repairs monitoring group, for instance, we came armed with all sorts of figures, and they said, oh, bugger off, you know. We don't want to know about that. We want to talk about certain subjects. We want to talk about dampness, and we want to talk about how long it takes to get it repaired. And we said, fair enough. These are the subjects we'll talk about. And, you know, in that way, if we acquiesce to how they want the thing to run, we can get some measure of understanding.
Tuesday morning, and it's wet and very windy. Roystonhill's the highest point for miles around, so a westerly gale coming in from the Atlantic has a clear run until it hits number 20, and people have to hang on to their messages and their children for dear life. A day like this is the great test of the waterproofing in the block, and it's a test number 20 quite simply fails. This, believe it or not, is the drying area, and if water can get in here, it can get in anywhere in these great monoliths so cleverly built right on top of the hill.
I'm sure the architects who designed them thought they're going to look wonderful, but whether it makes sense to build blocks that are so exposed with a form of construction that isn't up to meeting the weather conditions, obviously it's not. It's crazy to do that. In my investigations, I've identified 10 major areas of problems, and each of those areas is going to cost a fortune to put right. Now, if they actually added up all those costs and did a life cycle costing exercise on the building, they might well find that it's just not economical to repair them, that the costs of doing that are greater than actually knocking down and rebuilding or rehousing the tenants elsewhere.
Is there anything at all, though, that people who feel trapped in a building like that can do to make their own homes more attractive, more livable?
There's very little they can do, especially if they're on low incomes. The conditions in these blocks means that it costs a fortune to heat them and keep them warm. Because of the dampness and condensation, you can't keep them properly decorated, clothes get ruined, furniture gets ruined. So I don't think there's a lot that they can do. The only thing that they can do is to campaign for the local authority to do something about the problems, and that's the only route open to them.
Well, no one could accuse this group of not campaigning hard. Three women, members of the committee of the Roystonhill Tenants Association.
The likes of me, when I went up there, I two kids, one a 3, 1 a 6 month, and I was so happy to get away for the house I was in because it had been storm damaged. And I was so happy to get a bathroom. I wouldn't have cared. And it wasn't, oh, wonderful paradise. But at first, when I did move in there, neighbours all got friendly, and there was 10 of us actually got together. And we used to go with prams, this is the truth, and go to the fruit market, and we got potatoes, carrot, turnip, and we divide them because we came for a small rent, you know, like private factor rent, to treble your rent. So we went away to the fruit market and got all these things. Well, we were cutting prices that way, right? So we dished it out between 10. It weighed it all. We all got the same. We'd done this for weeks. We used to go to the young mothers around the church. Great. We had a great thing going up in that block. But things started to deteriorate.
Why do you think this sort of community element that Helen's talking about there broke down, Marjorie?
People get thoroughly fed up asking for things to be done, nothing been done. And as Helen says, good money flung after bad, seeing things done and nothing was coming yet. And we find that, nothing against the tenants now, and we can't blame them, that public meetings that we have, there's an awful lot of apathy. Oh, this has been going on for years, so nothing will change. What are you trying to do?
I've just really got angry, because I was thought, go out and vote for the man, because he's out there shouting, coming to your door telling you, no matter what you want done, I'm the man, I'll do it. And all of a sudden, I can't find all these people that you vote for. They don't want to know me. I mean, they're just not, and I am that way minded. I'm no militant, I'm no political. I'm just a housewife trying to live in a decent home, a dry home. And let me, I can't believe it. How these people can sit there and say, I'm there to help you. And when you go for help, they're full of the, certainly, I'll do this. Don't you worry, Mrs. Fletcher, I'll do that. See, as soon as I get that door, they get that bit of paper and they go, oh, she can wait along with the rest.
You give people decent conditions to live in, they'll respond to it. You give people horrible conditions to live in and they just give up. Everything just goes downhill.
But there are people living in high-rise blocks in the city who are satisfied with their accommodation.
Yes, right. Yes, my mother stays in a block of high-rise flats up in Springburn, Scottish special flats. Beautifully maintained, controlled entry system, well looked after. You want a repair done, it's done like that. There's houses in Moss Park, high-rise flats. There's other flats over in Scotstoun, beautifully maintained. But those hell holes, those, I better not use the word, those hovels up there aren't fit to live in.
There's a difference, though, between dampness and water penetration.
No, there isn't.
No, there isn't. Dampness is dampness.
I don't care what technical expert wants to try and qualify it. It's a case you can get water penetration dampness, condensation dampness, rising dampness. Dampness is dampness, and it's in these houses, and it shouldn't be there. It's not our problem. It's up to us to say to them, look, by the way, this house is damp. It's not my problem. It's yours. It's your house. You're the landlord. I mean, people knew 17 years ago that this shouldn't ever have been built. But the thing was, as Helen says quite rightly, a lot of people were living in houses which didn't have inside toilets. They didn't have proper kitchen facilities, and they were quite glad to go into them at that time. But right now, what we are seeing is, it's an absolute joke. We don't want them. We don't need them. It's not working. And if the local authority is not prepared to do something about it, then central government should. They should be getting money up here and sorting this out properly.
And another group with the same message for local and national politicians. It's still cold and windy outside, but in the school hall, indignation keeps the temperature up.
My daughter's the one that gets out most frequently because she goes to school. And every day when I go to collect her, the first thing she says to me, Daddy, when are we getting a house with clothes? I can't answer that. I go to the social work department, they try to help me. They phoned them, they said, I've got enough points for a house in Roystonhill. I go down to the rent office and talk again, I've not got enough points for the house I'm in. I don't want the house I'm in.
I've got three children, the three of them are under five, twin girls and a wee boy, right? Now, the only time the Waynes can get out is when I take them out. And they stand at the window and watch every day, when am I getting out? Now, they only get out when they go to the nursery school every day, right? That's the only time the Waynes get out. So, they see when they do get out, they go berserk. And they feel that way, they're closed in all the time. And it's setting me up the wall. And they told me I've been on to the council for a house, right? And they told me that I'll not get a house until the Waynes are 10-year-old. So I've got... I'm overcrowding, right? I've got overcrowding points. But they told me that I've not to get one to... The children are 10. So what about a day of just to stick it out, you know what I mean? I can't do nothing else.
Kids coming from school at dinner time getting stuck in these lifts and you have to go and phone the fire brigade to come and get the kids out and they're taking the lift up halfway and dragging these kids out.
Our weeing was stuck in the lift one Sunday about 3 months ago, from 12:25 to 3:25. No caretaker or anything to be found. Phoned the fire brigade, they were out for 2:45. And it was still the back of three that the weeing got out.
Well, I've been 14 years in the house, and it's always I've had a damp room, the damp scullery, the damp living room. Now it's in the hall. The grey fungus has grown up the wall in the hall. And my bills are near 100 every quarter, and it doesn't make the slightest difference how much heating I put on. I've even had to lift the line on the scullery to kill beetles, washing down walls, everything, and it doesn't make the slightest difference. And now I've been flooded out with the tanks getting cleaned. So that's another problem. My three children are staying up in my sister's house because they can't use the room because the water flooded into it.
It's not real, it's not real life. Getting beamed up and getting beamed down. I mean, that's not real life, that. Even looking out your window, wee dots. Sometimes you're higher than the birds that fly by your window. And you got all the different smells, everybody different cooking and all that through your house. Demolish them. Put a bomb in them. Blow them up.
This is going over the top, would be in favour of demolition of these houses.
Everybody. Unanimous.
8 and 4, 84. 1 and 8.
Wednesday, so it's been...
Bray. A group of ladies from the surrounding area have lunch together and spend the afternoon marking their cards. Some of them reckon that this is their best chance of getting a house.
6:56, 7 and 3, 73.
This small flat's the only community facility for Roystonhill. A new hall's at the planning stage, but most of the ladies here regard that, as usual, as too little and coming too late to stop the rot in the area.
Well, we had a lovely flat up to no bother at all to this while back. Like my glass broken, the vandals are running up and down, they're putting their name to who's lying aside me for weeks. We just don't know who's going to get it. We don't know who the other ones come in, as I say. We don't know who they are or anything. It's ruined.
My house was damp and it was black fungus in the scullery bathroom. Water running down the hall and all that. And it was unbearable. I couldn't take any minute.
How did you manage to get a transfer?
How did I say? I fought. And they offered me houses down in Royston Court. It was unfit for a human being to live among glue sniffers, you name it. Was I going down among people that was worse than myself? I'm not any better than anybody else, but I pay a big rent, I think I'm entitled to a wee bit better accommodation.
You were telling me that it's because the people have changed since you first of all got your house.
Well, a lot of people have changed, new people. The good people has went out, and the people they're bringing in now is not with a... You don't want to know them.
Oh, I believe you there.
Why, what sort of people are coming on?
Well, they're not stairs and landing and anything. I mean, yeah. If you go to take a house, you want to keep it, to make it something better than you. You want somebody that's half decent going to make a place good for the living, isn't it?
And another thing we've complained about is dogs. I've put in complaints about dogs.
Have the council not made efforts, though, to make sure that the dogs are less of a nuisance?
Oh, no. Yes. They sent up a van, a dog catcher. So the van moved all around the place. And all the dogs got word of it. And that particular day, there was not a dog to be seen. The dog catcher kept going round and round. No dogs, only somebody had a dog in a lead. And after the dog catcher went away, so help me. They were all right, closer than ever. That's the truth. I swear to you.
And we're on the second top floor. That's level 23. Flat 2, Mr. and Mrs. Carberry, and two wee boys, Sean and Stephen. What are your main complaints about the high flats here?
It's more to do with the children. It's the upbringing they're going to have up here. They kind of get out to play. Comes home at school for 3 o'clock. That's him in for 3 o'clock till he goes to school next morning. Well, that's either my wife and myself get well. My other wee boy, he's never out unless 1 year's ago.
So what's this hole on the roof up behind me?
That was they were drilling up the stair to see about the condition of the building. And they drilled right through into your house.
And did it do any damage? Because it looks as though there's quite a big hole there.
Yeah, it smashed a nest of tables and a table lamp, and cut the side of the suite when the glass was flying off. And my wee boy, he was lying sleeping on the side of the couch when the couch was over in that corner at the time. That's why we moved it.
Eric Downey's a structural engineer who's made a special study of high-rise blocks. He's interested in the steel cladding that's been wrapped around some of them in a desperate and expensive attempt to banish dampness. But tenants wonder whether this block will ever be properly watertight.
Was it a sensible thing to build a structure like this straight on to the Atlantic, more or less? It seems to me to be a peculiar sighting for such an exposed thing.
Well, on the face of it, it must be very, very exposed. But in technical terms, the wind strengths you get in the whole of Scotland are in the severe category. And really, at the top of a building this height, it isn't going to make very much difference where the thing is.
That's theoretically. I spoke to a lady yesterday who's kitchen had been flooded because it's on this side of the building which takes the worst of the winds.
Oh well, that may be so, but it wouldn't matter. Even if the building was down on low ground at that height, the wind pressure, the rain would just be the same, and the fault that caused that would still apply. It wouldn't matter whether it was on top of a hill or not.
Now, one of the reasons though for the cladding going onto this building was to firstly tackle the condensation dampness and presumably also to tackle what the tenants alleged to be penetration. And it
seems to me, just looking at it very quickly, that there are seams that water could still get through.
It's a very difficult thing. We have actually tested a number of cladding systems for this type of block and found it that people find it very difficult to seal them completely. And water penetration is a possibility, and it's something that must be guarded against very carefully.
And so it is feasible for tenants to complain that even after the cladding, there is water penetration in their homes?
Oh yes, it's quite possible.
We've also discovered something very strange about number 20. The actual building doesn't match the approved drawings of it held in the city archives. In particular, the lifts, which should be at opposite ends of the building, according to the drawings, are both at one end, which means that emergency fire doors are in daily use.
Well, according to the drawing, the lifts are here and here, but in fact, they're located there and there.
Now, even if moving the lifts from here on the plans to the opposite side doesn't necessarily weaken the structure of the building, does it not mean that in this whole central area there have been changes that aren't recorded in the plan now?
Well, presumably there would be a drawing done showing the lifts in the correct position. You know, this, they wouldn't simply change it on the spur of the moment. And there must somewhere, it may not be available now, but there must somewhere be a drawing showing the correct situation. But I take your point. I mean, it is nice for the owner of a building to have an as-built drawing, and I'm sure there was an as-built drawing for this building at the time, but it, over the years, perhaps it disappeared.
On the top floor, an empty flat is being taken to pieces. The District Council want to find out just how carefully number 20 was put together 18 years ago. With buildings like this, huge panels have to be bolted together, just like a house of cards.
What's that up there for time?
Well, this is a sandwich panel. There's two leaves of concrete with insulation in between. These are tied together by a mild steel tie, and they're cutting open to see if there is a tie there.
There isn't one there.
No, in fact, in that particular case, they've missed it. But you'll see there's a piece of metal there, and I think probably the metal detector picked that up, and the tie just doesn't happen to be at that spot. But the ties are not put in at very regular centres, and it's probably just a little bit further down.
What about in general for this type of building? Is there a tendency for ties like that perhaps to be missed at the construction stage, perhaps careless building?
So far as I know, in this particular type, there is no evidence of that, but this has been found in other types of building. The ties have been missing, and of course that's very important.
Right, can I ask you about this one now here? Because this isn't a tie. What's this? Is that not meant to wrap around here?
Yeah. This is a load-bearing gable wall here, and this is the join. And the precast panels come up to this point. They then place reinforcement and pour concrete in. It does look as though that bar should probably tie around the other bar. It may have been displaced, of course, when they broke this open, but probably it should have been round that other bar.
Now, is that a serious mistake?
No. The concrete, this is very, very strong concrete. It bonds to the steel, provided there is sufficient concrete there and sufficient steel there. It is not in itself very serious. It doesn't really rely on the steel being hooked onto the other bar, although it's better if it is.
But we can see this bit because the wall's been opened up. Are there other points in the construction of this type of wall with the two big slabs having to be bonded together that we might not be able to see that will also have that mistake?
Oh, it's quite possible. I mean, this detail recurs throughout the entire block at every join of two panels, and you're depending on this joint being correctly formed.
And so, therefore, if this is magnified, say even just once a floor, that's 24 times over, do you start worrying about it then?
Well, it's a question of degree. I think, yes, if that occurred every time, you might think that there was reason to suppose that quality control wasn't all that it might have been. But in itself, it's not a very important factor. But what they will be doing, I'm sure, is making a statistical sample, taking a certain percentage of all the panels and checking, and then in the light of what they find, they'll decide whether anything else is necessary.
And this is level 15, flat 4, and it's a young couple who live in here, Mr. and Mrs. Marinan and their son John.
What about when the weather was really bad a couple of days ago?
Oh, that, the water was actually coming in the windows and out my curtains and out my carpet.
Are you sure it was water coming in the windows?
Yes,
and not
water.
Just the condensation?
No, it was water, because because I had to get a towel and soak it all up at the bottom of the window here, on the ledge.
Oh, you can see, actually.
Yes.
So, where does he go out to play here?
He can't go out at all, because he's too small now to go on the lifts or press buttons or things, so I've got to take him out with me, and I don't get out much myself because of the lifts. Because it means if I go out, I've got to carry him up the stairs now the lifts are off.
If this flat had a warden service and if it had security, would it be a good place to live then?
No, I don't think so.
Why not?
Because I don't like the flats at all. I'd rather put the flats. I don't think you should be really in flats with the security or not. I'd rather have a low down house so you can get in and out of a garden with the child's sake.
Okay.
Friday night and the Royston Social Club. A chance for people in the area to put the problems of the week behind them. For tonight, anyway, they can forget the daily struggle with dampness, broken lifts and officialdom. And dampness isn't the only problem. Male unemployment is nearly 40% and almost half the households are on officially low incomes. Just the sort of setup that could drive you to drink, provided, of course, you could afford it. So what does Glasgow District Council think about their property at number 20? Billy James McLean ought to know. He's the city's housing convener, whose own ward includes part of Royston Hill.
Should you not just reduce that high living that nobody likes to the ground and then build the sort of houses at ground level that people and families want to live in?
Well, this is something that's easier said than done. I mean, Glasgow has 259 multi-storey blocks. Even if the council took a decision or a policy decision to demolish one multi-storey block a year and replace it with other types of housing, it would take us 259 years to clear the multi-storey blocks in the city.
But this is an absolutely dreadful place. The stairs in the multi-storey block are impassable. People are living in houses that they can't keep wallpaper in the walls. The lifts break down 4 or 5 times a day on average in the first quarter of 1985. It's a dreadful place.
Well, let's face it, I'm only a politician in this game. We have fully paid professional officers that have to carry out a particular job of work. I would expect them to carry out that particular job of work. I would expect the organisations to work with those officers in attempting to improve their own environment. And where we as a local authority are putting in hard cash, and hard cash that's very difficult to get at this period of time, into those areas, that the tenants' organisations must adopt a position of responsibility to ensure that that money is not badly spent in an area.
So there's absolutely no hope for all the people that we've spoken to who are stuck in multi-stories, just desperate to get out. They've got to stay there.
There is very little hope, really. We can only hope as a local authority, in conjunction again with the tenants, to try and improve the blocks that they are in. We are not in a situation to have a new build programme, and it will be some time before we can even resolve that one. Yes, I can't see much hope in the near future for that at all, that we're going to have to live with what we've got and try and improve what we've got, keep bringing pressure on national government for the need for investment and make sure that we can get a programme rolling.
But regardless of the reasons why, and despite the financial pressures on local authorities, the new slums are just as rotten for the people living in them as the old ones were. So isn't it time for politicians to admit that blocks like number 20 have no future as houses fit for people to live in?